this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very
Well, good morning and happy Easter to you and wherever you are. We are so delighted to be worshiping with you this Easter morning online. Whether you are on Facebook or you're on our website watching this later, it's Easter and we are excited for a great morning of worship. I want to say a special thank you to Harry and his family, and he is in Kentucky, and one of the great privileges is that he was able to send us that incredible prelude, and we're glad to share that with you this morning. Wherever you are this morning, and whatever you're watching on, whether it's a TV, a computer, an iPad, welcome to worship, and happy Easter to you. I invite you to join us as we begin.
Hear this call to worship. In this room, we recognize the wilderness in the world. In this room, we trust that God is near. In this room, we hold on to hope. In this room, we hold on to each other. In this room, we sing Alleluia. In this room, we trust that love is stronger than hate. So in this room, we celebrate. In this room, we sing. In this room, we trust that nothing can separate us from God's word. Let us worship Holy God.
Alleluia. God of new life, we come to you confessing that we are guilty of creating emotional wilderness spaces. Spaces of raised voices and slamming doors, of judgments passed and accusations cast, of cold shoulders and deep regret. We create these spaces when we feel threatened, afraid, or ashamed, which is far too often given the promises you make to us. So draw us back to the beginning, where you created and it was good. Smooth over our wilderness scars and fill our veins with your love. For like the disciples on that Easter morning, we are running towards you. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Songs of Emmanuel should ring. Christ hath brought us heaven's choices, heavenly music let it ring. Alleluia, alleluia, Easter people, let us sing. Fear of death can no stop us from oppressing here below. For our Lord empowered us to triumph over every foe. Alleluia, alleluia, unto victory now we go. Every day to is Easter with its resurrection song. When in trouble, move the faster to our God who rights the wrong. Alleluia, alleluia, see the power of heavenly throne.
Morning. Happy Easter. Thanks, Mark.
You're welcome.
Look, Mark got me an egg. I hope it's got red and green jelly beans in it because it's my favorite. Oh, look, it's a little Jesus. That makes me think of two things. First of all, we all need a little Jesus in our life. And second of all, this empty egg makes me think of an empty tomb. You know, Jesus has been busy this week. Last Sunday, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, and the people waved palm branches, singing, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus cleaned out a temple this week, and he gave us a great commandment. Jesus had expensive perfume poured on him, and he taught his disciples a little lesson. And then on Thursday, Jesus had his last supper with his disciples. And he told them to do this in remembrance of me. He was arrested, tried, crucified, and laid in a tomb. And 3 days after Jesus died, Mary Magdalene and Mary went to the tomb. And when they got there, the rock had been rolled away. And they were so upset. What had happened? They didn't notice, but there was somebody there in white. It was an angel. And the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid. I know who you're looking for. And he's not in there. He's risen. Go tell the others, go tell the disciples that Jesus is alive." And they did. And you know, friends, if that rock hadn't been rolled away and if that tomb wasn't empty, we wouldn't have Jesus. And we all need a little Jesus in our life. Hallelujah, Jesus is alive. Let us pray. God, thank you for an empty tomb, and thank you that we have Jesus with us always and forever. Amen.
And thank you, April. Let us continue with a time of prayer. Oh God, what an amazing day we celebrate. For it is a day that new light bursts forth and darkness is cleared. Today we find an empty tomb. We find that a grave could not hold back the new life that you were and are bringing into our world. And so, like the women and the men at the tomb that morning, we stand amazed. Amazed because of your display of self-giving love was stronger than fear and hate and injustice and oppression. Easter morning proves to us that the life of humility and sacrifice and love that you lived still finds victory with us today. And so we stand in the beautiful aftermath of such a morning. May we come to experience this empty tomb for ourselves. But we know we don't have to linger there too long because you are not there. You are risen. We celebrate this morning not just your resurrection, but ours too. You are not in that tomb, so bring us out of ours too. For you are a God who goes before us, awakening life and breaking open resurrection. On the cross, sin's reign was finished, but your grace was just getting started. It is not finished. It is still at work because that tomb is empty. And yet, God, this year everything is different. We're not together. We can't share in our meals and in our egg hunts together. But maybe this also puts us more closely to that tomb of that first Easter, where we experience this day amidst the uncertainty of what's happening and the hope of your powerful grace being alive. And so we pray for your resurrection in our lives today, perhaps like never before. We pray for your resurrection in our family and in our friends who need your experience of love and grace. We pray for your resurrection in our broken and our aging bodies and in our world that seems to be in full chaos. We pray for your resurrection in our schools, in our work, in our country, and all over the globe. Oh God, we pray that we would be witnesses to it, recipients of it, and workers for it. So break open your glory and burst forth your resurrection in us and through us and all around us. All this we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, as we join together, as you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Friends, as we come to our offering this morning, we continue to give you thanks for your support of the ministry here at Katy First as we continue to reach out into our community, not only in the coming days, in the coming weeks and the months. So we appreciate the many ways and the many people who continue to support us. You can do that at our website at katyfirst.org/give. You can also do that as a text to give option, and that number is 281-607-4095. Thank you for the way that you are supporting us as we continue to do good work in this community together. As we come for our offering, let me lead us in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for so many ways that you are showing up in our life, even in this season that we are experiencing. We know that your blessing is still at work in this world. And so as we continue to be faithful in the way that we give of ourselves through our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, we ask that you would receive them and you would use them here in Katy and far beyond. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Christ has risen while the sun does. Christ has risen where hope dies.
As he said and as he promised. exist as we doubted and denied.
Let the moon embrace the blessing. Let the sun sustain the cheer.
Let the world confirm the rumor.
Christ is risen, God is here.
Christ has risen and forever lives to challenge and to change.
All whose lives are messed and mangled, all who find religion strange.
Christ is risen, Christ is present, making us what he has been. Evidence and transformation in which God is known and seen.
Christ is risen, Christ has risen, Christ has risen, Christ has risen.
Good morning. Welcome again to this service of worship. 5 months ago, when we began to plan for Holy Week and for Easter, my thoughts were more about how many worship services that we would need and how many people would be attending in both the sanctuary and the confluence service. I think the staff and I assumed that this Easter would be like last year's and the year before and the year before that. None of us could really foresee celebrating Easter in a sanctuary that was empty, where there is in this room quite enough room for all of us. I glance at the morning headlines and I found very little about Easter there. There was no proclamation that Christ is risen, no response that Christ is risen indeed. In fact, what I found there was very little good news proclaimed. Instead, in those headlines, there was the announcement that 110,000 people have died and over 1.8 million people had been infected by COVID-19. And to put that in perspective, on Thursday, as I began to write this sermon, the number was 95,000 dead and 1.6 million who had been infected. It feels to me like we are at war with a very powerful and invisible enemy. And like our grandparents and great-grandparents of generations ago who listened to the radio for any word on the war effort, hoping not to hear their husband's or their son's or their brother's name read out among the dead, so we today find ourselves in our own battle. And we long in hope for that day when the victory is won and all the battles have been ended. I long for that day when we can gather again here at church. We can worship together. We can go to the grocery store without fear. We can walk in the park or along the beach because we have that opportunity that this disease has been defeated. But I also wonder if we can ever go back to that time before, or if we should even want to. This morning, our scripture lesson comes from John's Gospel. I'll be reading from the 20th chapter, verses 1 through 18. Would you bow your heads as we pray for illumination? O Lord, we ask that you would open up our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you are saying to us this day. For we pray this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and ran toward the tomb. The two of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him, and he went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been laid on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you crying?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he said all these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I have to admit that it is strange to be preaching in an empty sanctuary that feels like the empty tomb. While I have my share of angels surrounding me today, giving leadership to this worship service, I have to confess that something is missing. Our Lenten journey to this point and time has been long and fraught with unexpected twists and turns that could not be foreseen. Our Holy Week has been dominated by fear and anxiety, disruption and loss. On Good Friday, we felt that discomfort It became real to me and to all of us as those events in Jesus' life were cascading towards his betrayal, arrest, crucifixion, and death. We understand more fully why the disciples fled for their lives, running away and distancing themselves from the cross. Jesus dies alone. There is no family to surround him, no friends to watch over him, no hand to comfort him, no final kiss. It even appeared that God had abandoned him. And he dies, and he is taken to be buried in a borrowed tomb. While I've heard this story time and time, year after year, it did not strike me like the gut punch that it should have. But this year, it did. The parallels of what is happening in ICUs all across our nations, where those who are victims of COVID-19 lay in beds with respirators separated from their families. They cannot be comforted by their friends. There is no hand that they can hold on to. No final goodbye to be said. They're even taken to temporary morgues where there they will lie, as cold and as dead as Jesus was. You see, their death is a real death. It is an agonizing death. At least it is agonizing for the family and friends that grieve around them. Their death is just as real as the death of Jesus. And their agony, because of the distance that separated them, is just like the agony of Mary Magdalene. You see, that first Easter was filled with grief and pain for Mary Magdalene. She felt the distance and the sorrow of separation. That Easter morning, she ran back to the disciples, telling them that the stone had been rolled away, leaving them all wondering what had happened. Had their faith in Jesus been misplaced? Were the naysayers that ridiculed them for leaving home and family and friends to follow after this Messiah, were they right when Jesus lay in the tomb? I'm not sure that Mary, where she got the strength to go in the dark of night to the tomb of Jesus, taking step after step, confused, overwhelmed by grief, she arrives there and she finds that the stone has been rolled away. She is now entered into a new wilderness where Jesus does not walk. She is a stranger in a strange land. And like those who lamented over the destruction of the temple and of the holy city, who were exiled to a foreign land, they cried out, "How can we sing the songs of Zion while living in a foreign land?" And I wonder how we can today sing, "Christ the Lord is risen today," when everything familiar in our world has changed. I wonder how we can sing, "Easter people, raise your voices," when so many have lost their jobs, their health insurance, their security. How can we sing this song in this foreign and strange land, except for the devotion of Mary Magdalene, who dared to go to the tomb and found the stone rolled away? You see, it didn't make sense to her. It didn't make sense to Peter or the beloved disciple who raced with Mary to see for themselves, but they did not yet understand the scripture that Jesus must be raised from the dead. Only Mary remained. Only Mary stood there weeping. And it was only Mary who saw the two angels seated where the body of Jesus had been laid, one at the head, one at the feet. It was only Jesus, it is only Mary who sees the resurrected Jesus, and yet she does not really know him. It wasn't until he spoke her name, Mary, that she realizes that she sees the risen Christ standing before her. And everything in her world and our world is changed in that moment. And her reaction was to cling, to hold on to Jesus. But that good news was too powerful to be held onto. But rather she goes and she tells the other disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she proclaims to them all that Jesus had said to her. And in that moment, all the world was changed. It would never be the same, because Christ's victory over sin and death is our victory as well. Everything in the world had changed. It was a cosmic victory over the dead with life. It was also a victory for the creation that yearns for the revealing of the sons and daughters of God. We no longer need to fear death, for the promise of the resurrection is of ongoing transformation, not only for us, but for all the world. And as Jesus was transformed through the resurrection, appearing differently to Mary and later to the disciples, so we are being transformed, not by our own efforts or by our own willpower or desire, but by the reality of Jesus' birth, life, death, and ascension. You see, it is you and I who believe in the resurrection who are being changed. It is all the men and women and children of this world who have been rescued by the power of Christ's resurrection. And because of that, the world is different today, even though we may not yet see it fully. I see this whenever we baptize a child. The parents present the baby. The water is applied. Sacred words are spoken. And once the water has dried, you may look at her and wonder, what just happened? What's different now than before? And everyone in church that day would tell you, oh, everything has changed. Because she has been adopted into the family of God. She has been claimed and named and ordained as Christ's own possession. And it is our job as the church to guide her as she walks and matures in her discipleship to Christ. It is when I can see this, when a man and a woman stand in front of the altar, and there they make promises to one another. There is the blessing, and then they leave. And everyone in the church may wonder what's different about them now than was before. And people would tell you, oh, everything's different in their life. And they will take a lifetime to figure out how to live into those promises that they made. A family gathers around a grave with nothing but a prayer and a promised hope that one day they will see their loved one face to face. But now there is still the grief and pain of death. Now, after the benediction is given, what has really changed? Death is still a reality. Their pain is still real, and yet everything has changed in the best and the worst sense of the word. You see, the Apostle Paul put it this way, "Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed in the twinkling of an eye at the sound of the last trumpet. The dead shall be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed." You see, there is a power at work in this world because Christ has been raised from the dead. There is a power that is greater than sin and death that we can see that is a part of Christ resurrected and at work and in each one of us, even when we don't see it. Mary Magdalene didn't see it at first, nor did the other disciples, until the resurrected Christ stood before them. But once they saw him as he really was, nothing was the same after that first Easter. And their message transformed the world. You see, there is a power at work that is greater than COVID-19. And that power is the power of Christ's resurrection. Can you see it? There is a power at work in this world that can be found in the courage of doctors and nurses and medical personnel that are working on the front lines of those who are dying, who have placed themselves in harm's way and have looked death in the face and said, "Not today, not on my watch." Can you see it? I see it in the faces of those cashiers that work in grocery stores and janitors that serve in hospitals. I see it in those first responders who go and help those who are in need because they feel this deep calling to make a difference in their lives. Can you see it? I see it where scientists and researchers around our world have joined together in unity to find a cure, a vaccination for this disease, unlike they have ever done before. Can you see it? Can you see the power of Christ's resurrection transforming this world from the way it was to the way it is becoming? And I don't know about you, but tomorrow I'm going to go looking for Jesus. I'm going to be looking for those people in whose faces I can see the transformational power of God at work in each one of them. I'm going to look for where Jesus is. I don't know where he is right now. I don't know exactly what situation I will find him, but I do believe that the transforming work of the resurrection is happening in me and in you and throughout this whole world. And if we look for it, we will see it. For Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Praise to his name.
And now, friends, may by the power of God who has granted new life to us through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, may we go forth from this place in power and love to change the world. For we are sent in Christ's holy name. Amen.